pleased to present Jim Dina, an expert on the tools, travel, and skill of the Stone Age people who once inhabited Connecticut. Jim crafts his own flint knives and basalt axes using original Indian techniques and also fires clay pots and weaves baskets as these people once did here. But what he may be best known for and what he will be talking about tonight is his handcrafted replica birch bark canoe named the Ant. Jim and the Ant journeyed down the Connecticut River just as the ancients once did. Tonight's program, The Voyage of the Ant, promises to be compelling and enlightening, and I am pleased to present to you Jim Dina.
Thank you very much. It's nice to be back here. And how long ago was that last time? I've lost track.
15 years.
15 years. Okay. Okay. Amazing people are still talking about this. I guess this was supposed to be about canoeing, but not really. And I was kind of amazed when I first began to talk about this the year after I did this, which was 1985, I think. A little younger then. No more foolish than that. I realized that it wasn't just canoeing clubs that asked me to talk about this kind of stuff. It was historical societies. It was all kinds of people. And sometimes when you do something yourself, you don't quite realize what you did exactly. Until someone asks you about it, you say, hey, I have to explain it. And it's about canoeing in a way, but it's also about looking back. And I consider people in historical societies, and especially people who own antiques, obviously they have some reverence for the past and an affinity for it. There's some values there that they like. And if you own antiques and put them in your house, isn't this a wonderful thing you can actually sit on, dine at them, and use them and live with them, that kind of thing. Or you don't have to put them away in a case and just look at them like that. They're really a part of your life. And this were really what was interested in me. I was very interested in Native Americans and certain things about their lifestyles before they met Europeans. And especially their close connection with nature and things like that. And I live along the Connecticut River in South Windsor. We'll see some scenes of it in a few minutes. And I used to look for arrowheads and find arrowheads and pieces of arrowheads and pieces of pottery. And I realized after a while I got tired of collecting these things. I was really looking for the guy who made them. I said, how do you do that? Lacking the proverbial time machine. How do you go back there and really do this? And of course, we do this. We read books, huh? Do you young guys here ever read any books about Indians? For sure. You know, you probably camped out and played Indian for a night or two, or maybe much longer than that. You've seen movies about Indians. When you're through with all that, what do you do next? How do you get a real life experience? Well, that's kind of what I was after. And I guess I could have bought a canoe or borrowed a canoe, a birch canoe. I probably could have purchased one and made a little trip on the Connecticut River on it. But I came up with an idea. I said, my real shot at maybe becoming this guy who's no longer here is maybe doing what he did. And if I do that, maybe I'll find out a little bit about how he thought, how he felt. And so, as you can imagine, and when I ask kids about this fairly often, I said, well, we're going to go on a river trip. What do we do first? And I said, well, you need a canoe. I said, well, we don't have one. And they said, well, let's build one. I said, all right, well, what do you want to do first? Well, let's saw down a tree. I said, sorry, I forgot to tell you. We don't have any tools yet. We got to build it. And so that's the painfully basic point that I started out with, if you could picture it, the old catchphrase, naked into the wilderness. Well, I wasn't quite naked physically, but technologically completely naked. I had a couple of tools at my disposal, my teeth. They're pretty good tools. You use them at mealtime. Your fingernails, you can scratch into a few things, soft stuff. They're not bad tools in a pinch. But I started literally by cracking two stumps together and produced knives like this. And this is, we often call them leaf knives, and they're pretty. They almost look like a leaf shape. There's a little leaf knife. I'll have these out here to post them combined and see them later. Here's a slightly longer one, and when youngsters find these, they often figure, aha, I found a spear point. It's not really a spear point. It's a knife. Spear points are smaller. Arrow points are much smaller. Right? But they're very efficient cutting tools. These are made of flint. There's local stones that work, too. And, of course, I can use this particular blade if I need to. It works nicely handheld. I can use that particular blade to cut its own hand and its own tying material, various tying materials, barks, things like that, glues, the pitch of a pine tree. And so very slowly, I started to recreate the technology needed to make everything, including a canoe. Here's a bone piercing tool and awl. We'll see this in service on the building of the canoe. And once you've made your flint knives, then you can carve a bone to split it down to length. And you can sharpen a piece of pavement, a curb, you know, if you're in the parking lot, or a piece of sandstone if you're out in the woods somewhere. All right. So slowly I began to build the kind of tools I would need. So those are the flint cutting tools. There are various others. Things like flint drills. I thought I had one in here. And there's one down here somewhere. Yeah, this would look like a little arrow for kids, but it's a flint tip, a narrow one, and it's a drill. It's fun between the hands. It takes a little while to drill a hole, but holes are really important for attaching things sometimes. The other set of tools that I needed, of course, were chopping tools. Now, flint splits very easily, huh? You tool these by hitting it with another stone and cracking off pieces. All the pieces left behind are sharp. The pieces that fall away are razor sharp. If you pound with that thing, or chop with it, that's a pounding technique, it'll retool itself or break. So we need very hard stones that won't crack. And this is a granite one. I found it almost this shape, but this is very smooth. And I worked it to shape by grinding it on a piece of sandstone. Now, this was so slow and monotonous. I didn't finish the axe that day. I didn't finish it next day. It was weeks before I finished it. And in fact, I forgot I was making an axe because the end was nowhere near in sight. And I discovered that this mentality was an important part of primitive peoples. They didn't have the expectation, well, we'll be through by dinner because we got a soccer game afterwards. So it changed it. We never have trouble with the young guys when we get out this way. No, we have trouble with them anyway, but they like this one. This one's built differently, and since we have a lot of historical things here in the society, this is often called an axe by archaeologists. We won't make a lecture out of that, but it's got a groove here behind the handle. You can't see. The handle just grips the groove. A lot of work to make that groove. This one is called a self. It's a tapered head, and every time I blow with it, it gets driven a little more deeply into the notch here. Now, much easier to make this shape. A little hard to make this hole in a piece of hickory. This drill isn't up to it. Anybody guess what tool we need? Well, make a big hole like that in a piece of hickory. You can see here that all this brown layer is the original cortex, the outer surface of the stone. Look at how little I banged away and sharpened. I searched on Halkett Mountain for about 3 hours for this stone. That 3 hour search saved me weeks of work making this axe. Native people were industrious when they had to be, but first they were usually clever. Okay? Alright, so axes, drills, knives, things like that. And if we ever got all that stuff, we made a few other things with them. Here's one of the products I made. This is a birch bark bucket. It's a water carrier, made in similar style of the canoe, stitched up with a pattern, and it's waterproof with pine pitch. There it is. There's a dipper. And made out of a gourd, simple things like that, right? And other things I needed to make. Cordage is one of the most important things you can make, tying materials. And here's a long piece of tying material I made. I'm not going to hide the end so nobody knows what it is. This is a 25-foot piece of cord, all right? And it's made out of pre-bark. Now, everybody thinks, well, you use rawhide or animal sinews. You have to catch the animal first. But which they did. They had animal hides and things like that. But if you're in a pinch, it needs a quick tying material, plant fibers. This is the inner bark of a basswood tree, and at the end is a little bone fish hook. And I don't think it takes too much imagination to picture how this wishbone can be turned into a bone hook, just cut off one side. So that was my fishing line, and I didn't catch record bass and trout on it. I caught sunfish on it. They don't need to be big, you just need a lot of them. Okay, so fishing line, something I need, a good way to get a meal on the river, clay pot. Okay, I carried a couple of them. I carried one like this, and it's a little grimy from the fire. It wasn't gourmet, but I got fed. I had a bowl, which I didn't bring tonight, which nested right outside of this. So I had two cooking vessels. I could put them together, pack them in that thing for compactness. All right, so let's say I did catch a fish, and I got a pot to cook it in. I need one more exceedingly important thing. What's that?
Pot holder.
Pardon me?
Pot holder.
No, no, that's easy.
Fire, top of grass.
Fire. Sure. And it's the acquisition of fire that made it possible for man, early man, to leave Africa 80,000, 100,000 years ago. Without that, he wasn't going to leave and go anyplace else other than a tropical climate. And I start my fires, who's famous for starting fires without matches? Boy Scouts, right? Okay, they have this very complicated thing called a bow drill. I have this two-piece fire kit. No, I can't think of any fire piece that has less, fire kit that has less than two pieces. I always pictured a caveman down in his haunches there, rubbing two sticks together like this, running and groaning, saying, "When's the fire coming?" You can do that. The efficient way is to turn this one, though, the fire drill, turning inside a fire board or hearth, okay, like that. Now, it's easy to make a short piece like this, but it doesn't spin very well. So I carry these two pieces, and I carry this when I have it, but I can make this very, very quickly out of several plants that grow wild, elderberry, forsythia, so a cattail stalk will work. Right? All I need is a tie in the end, the cattail leaf will be out for me, and this is an extension piece that I can make pretty readily. And basically just spin this one and that one, and it gets pretty hot after a while, and you get a spark. It does work. And I use this very simple fire kit because if I survive a canoeing accident and need a fire, nothing comes ashore but me. I can build this two-piece thing really fast with some broken stones. The Boy Scout kit, which has a bow and very strong string, can't build that quickly. All right? So my concept here was learn a harder method and remember the skills. And those will come ashore with you. And then you have a very simple two-piece fire kit. So that was the strategy. Okay, we're doing pretty well. And those are the basics, the essentials that I really needed. Yeah, here's the fire bow, huh? See this strong piece of hide, the raw hide. Everybody says, "Well, use your shoelaces." Don't dare. You really need those two shoelaces. You're holding your shoes on. Barefoot doesn't cut it if you've got a long way to go. Okay. And this is deer hide, pretty strong. It'll work. Last deer I saw in the woods, I whistled down and said, "Hey, Buck, loan me some hide. I'll give it back when I'm through." Okay. So, you know, animal fibers are difficult to come by. So that's why I don't use this more complicated but very efficient type of fire device. And a few other little things that I didn't necessarily need. I made my own soap. I remember my mother had this bar of brown or gray soap under the sink there, and the threat was if I talked back, she's going to wash my mouth out with it. So, anyway, this soap I made was at least that strong. You know, the dirt scattered before I got it on there. But I broke it up into crystals. You make soap out of what? You need some lye, which you could make from wood ashes. You know, pile them up and pail straw and drip water through and collect the water slowly as it drips through. And you need some tallow, which you get from boiling down fat, rendering fat. And I have all this stuff, of course, okay? So there was the soap, and I had this. I had this comb. My wife says, don't be a slob on this trip. Take care of yourself. I made this little comb. I had no idea what was going. I had no mirror. I didn't use that for too much. But I did have, I don't know if it's in here anymore, I had this flint flake on a little cedar stick. I don't see it. It was kind of a razor blade. And if I lathered up this soap here, I could almost shave with it. It was a lousy shave, more like a self-sacrifice than a clean shave. You know, so. But the concept was to not go out there and so-called rough it and come back flea bitten and be dragged. The concept was to take care of myself and live as well as I could. So that was the start of the project, building all of this stuff, and I felt, as I said, technologically extremely naked when I began. But by the time I started to build the canoe, I felt like I had a lot of power because I had started from the bottom and continually had to look uphill, not look at my chainsaw while I locked all that stuff up. And I said, this is the best I got here. And I started out with nothing but the fingernails and the teeth. So that was the concept that really made this thing gel. All right, enough talk. That's the intro, and let's actually go now and just see what I did with these tools and how it all worked out. We'll get this out of the way. Folks can come up and see all this stuff. Okay. All right, is this mic wired? I didn't think it was. Is there a way to turn it on? I don't know about. No, I'll just talk loud, okay? I invite folks, I've heard lectures like this, the guy goes on so long, and by the time he's through, you know, I forgot what my question was. So if you have a very short question, you know, yell it out.
It's on.
I'll give a short answer. If it's a complicated question, it is on. Anyway, I'll just talk loud. Here's a little book I had the good fortune to write about this particular adventure. I did that. It came out in 1989. It's this second printing out now. Little cryptic, why it's called Voyage of the Ant, an insect, which has nothing to do with water. But that'll all become clear as we proceed. I promise this is the only commercial. All right. So, this is where most people suggest we should have started, out in the forest, searching for a large birch tree. But of course, I started where? Back at home in the river meadows, down the Connecticut River, starting to produce all these tools. So now we're ready to go out into the forest and look. And here's a pretty large birch tree. Now, stone tools are not up to cutting down birch trees of this size. And this is about a 14-inch tree, the one on the right you're looking at. And if you want to cut a tree down that big, how do you do it? Fire. You build a fire around the bottom. Now, if you're going to do that in a birch tree, it's going to ruin the bark, right? So a stone axe just can't take a tree this big down. Okay, so I built a ladder first with the stone tools and climbed up the tree. And you can see I forget how we got this shot, so he was helping me. But from left to right, which is really vertical, I'm at the base of the tree now, you see that little line. I sawed right through the bark with my flint knife, and then I'm using a flatty stick, which is like a spatula. It's a green stick, and it bends easily, to get in underneath the bark, and it peels off very slowly, but it's not difficult. You have to use some care. You can see I already split the bark to the upper left of my hand. There's a split in it, but no problem. We took care of that later. All right, so that's the most essential thing, this crucial piece of birch bark. Everybody knows what color birch bark canoes are, right? What is it? I'm sorry, they're tan. Okay? Huh? It's the inside of the bark that faces the water. Now, I puzzle about this a little, but it's more smooth and more waterproof. It's the inside of the bark that keeps the trees watering. So that's the side you put toward the river water. So they're really tan. The white is on the inside, but the guys in the Hollywood movies, So there it is, all right? But this is, so once I had this roll of birch bark, that was really the essential piece that the canoe depended on. All right, now it looks like I'm about to take down this great big ash tree with this little puny stone axe. No way. All I'm doing is taking off the bark. All I have to do is, the bark is spongy, you can chop right through it and peel it right off. Now, the traditional way to make so-called ribs for the canoe, and you'll see what those are, they're like where your ribs are, you know, coming around. If you lay on your tummy, your ribs would be in the same position as the canoe's ribs, all right? We'll see that later. And the traditional thing is to split out cedar. Now, that's white cedar that doesn't grow around here. Our red cedar is loaded with knots, and so I figured I had to come up with an alternative, and I remembered about basket makers using ash. And ash has this quality that if you pound on the wood layers, you can separate it year by year. And so here's a club I borrowed from the Flintstones there. Anybody tell how I made that club? I burnt the handle down, huh? I just left the handle in the fire and rotated it every couple of minutes. You got to stay there and watch it, don't walk off, and scrape away the char to slim that handle. This is a hickory club. And after beating up and down on one